We have kept you waiting over long, I fear.
Not to worry, Alphino. We had some rather fine mulled wine to keep us company. Truth be told, you could have delayed your arrival a few moments more.
Gibreon got the spicing just right this time. His latest batch is not only delicious and warming, but soothing to the humours.
Indeed. But 'twas not to soothe our humours that we gathered here.
Ah, no, quite right. The matter of that poor dragoon.
You have discovered something. A means to save him?
Let us not jump to conclusions, shall we? Assess the facts presented, then make an educated analysis, as you were taught.
Pray, cast your mind back to the moment of Estinian's transformation. Do you recall how you described it to us? You spoke of the sudden pangs which racked his body when you took up both of Nidhogg's eyes, and of how his form was twisted thereafter into a shadowy semblance of the great worm.
When he appeared at Falcon's Nest, the worm's eyes were fused to his mail.
Would that only his armor had been corrupted. Snaking forth from the eyes, I descried dark tendrils which entangled his very being. His ether has been all but smothered.
Then he is lost to us forever?
What did I just say about jumping to conclusions? Ishtola clearly stated all but smothered. As I later discovered, her impression matched my own. Though Nidhogg's presence filled my mind's eye, beneath his seething aura, I sensed the merest hint of something else. And after listening to Ishtola's observations, I became more certain of my suspicion that the something else I had sensed was, in fact, the trace of a different will, submerged in the sea of Nidhogg's rage.
You mean?
Yes, 'tis like that Estinian spirit yet lingers.
Can we not wrest him from Nidhogg's grasp then? Tear the eyes from the armor?
We know not if that would serve to separate Worm's soul from man's. None have ever attempted such a feat.
Should it offer even the faintest hope of success, then by the gods, I shall be the first to try.
Alphino. By all means, hold fast to your hope, but be mindful of the dangers. Even should you succeed in excising the eyes from the dragoon's mail, we have no way of knowing if your friend's soul would survive so violent a separation. And that is to say nothing of the possibility that his would-be savior might become Nidhogg's next host.
But what other choice remains to us? Should the opportunity present itself, I will tear those foul orbs from Estinian's armor and trust in the resilience of his soul, even at the risk of mine own.
Ah, I found you at last. A messenger of the Temple Knights came to the manor some few hours past. The Lord Commander humbly requests the company of the Warrior of Light and Master Alphino.
Sir Emeric would speak with us. Very well, thank you, Anuwa.
T'would seem duty calls. Pray see to yours, and we shall return to ours.
Thank you, Ishtola, Kryl. Your words have given me hope where there was none. Come then, Sir Emeric awaits.
Alphino is allowing his feelings for this dragoon to cloud his thoughts. I worry he may do something rash. Keep an eye on him, would you?
They think more of their friends' deliverance than their foes' defeat. But will history commend their fealty or condemn their folly?
The conference held at Falcon's Nest was to be a celebration of the reconciliation twixt man and dragon. But the lingering shade of Nidhogg, clad in the flesh of the Azure Dragoon, did mark the occasion by spilling the blood of his own kind. A timely atrocity to remind the children of Ishgard that the Dragonsong War was far from over. And when fear gave way to fury, the call to arms rang out anew. Death to Nidhogg. Death to Nidhogg.
My friends, I thank you for coming.
You have had news of Nidhogg?
Alas, not. Our scouts range far and wide, but they have as yet found no trace of the Great Worm.
We dispatched an elite unit of dragoons to reconnoiter the churning mists, but even they returned empty-handed.
A pity.
Fear not, Alphino. We shall see the worm again soon enough. His words at Falcon's Nest attest to that. Indeed, he is like to come sooner than we would wish.
I assume Ishgard's defenses are being bolstered as we speak?
With all haste. I mean to call upon every able-bodied warrior at our disposal, from the Knights of the Four Houses to the men and women of the Watch. But I did not summon you to discuss strategy.
What then would you have of us, my lord?
I will speak plain. Now that Nidhogg is possessed of both of his eyes, no mortal force we can muster will repel him. That being the case, we must needs recruit an ally of equal strength.
You speak of Hraesvelgr?
I do. To whom else could we turn?
That he is Nidhogg's equal, I do not deny. Nor can I name another. But convincing the reclusive creature to do battle with his own brood brother will be How shall I put this?
It will be no small undertaking, yes. Estinian's report was most particular about Hres Velga's unwillingness to involve himself in the affairs of men. But much has changed since your visit to Somal. And if there is even a chance that the dragon may be swayed, I must plead our case. Whatever price the dragon asks of me, I shall pay it. Such was my oath, to defend the people of Ishgard. Come what may, my friends, the battle with Nidhogg will mark the end of my tenure as the acting head of church and state. Will you help me discharge this final duty?
We will, my lord, though I fear our involvement offers no guarantee of success. Come then, we will depart at your leisure.
Thank you, both of you. The city is yours, First Commander.
My lord, we shall pray for your swift return.
Great Hraesvelgr, 'tis not lightly that we beg this audience. Pray hearken to our words, for they concern the future of man and dragon both.
Greetings, Hraesvelgr. I am Emeric de Burrell, acting ruler of the nation of Ishgard. I am come before you to parley on behalf of my people.
Kom ulnosk en iek mon kin.
foresaw mine intent.
We understand that in your despair at man's betrayal, you seek only the refuge of solitude. But despite your protestations of spent faith, do you not still nurture the smallest flame of hope? I do. If you claim I see falsely, then tell me, why did you consent to bear Azel upon your back?
Is no. Kaisinia in. Holes esk dir valsu. Nesk an in esk.
So you do distinguish between those who acknowledge and repent their sins and those who perpetuate them. Interesting. It seems to me that you have not, in fact, lost faith in mankind as a whole. Rather, you weigh our respective merits by how we allow the past to influence our future.
Should we suffer ties of blood to bind our hands, then? Nay, if the crime is one of unconscionable evil, we must needs condemn it, even should the transgressor be our closest kin. When my father corrupted himself and his followers with the power of a primal, I beseeched the Warrior of Light to slay him, an act alike to patricide. That he did not die by my hand matters little. If anything, it heaps greater disgrace upon my name. But had my father not fallen, he would have drawn countless thousands into a holy war of hellish proportions, which I hold the greater crime. Thus did I order his execution, sparing the lives of my people and yours. Alas, your brother Worm now prepares to murder those whom I sought to spare. What is more, he has taken my comrade's body for his own. But if I must slay my dearest friend to defeat my direst foe, I will not flinch from my duty.
Segmorn Idvin, Sesgantis Ekmorn, Kil al-Ud. Slowskna, Dyrkin Illes. Kol hes na inish traor in. Eskniteg Eskdir Ulgar An El in An Hesnesh An Eskjas Ong N Arm On Inga. Al in On Ulwoga Sma Hes In An. Sway in Ratatoska this die an. Slosk kin.
Thank you.
slain.
Thank you.
Nun ernst dahin!
Your trial is ended as well, then.
Mine was brutal beyond reckoning. Verdfolnir seems ill-acquainted with the notion of mock battles.
Our negotiations proved rather more strenuous than I had anticipated, but the results seem well worth the effort.
The battle was indeed hard won. Thank you, my friends. I would never have earned Trace Velga's cooperation had you not seen fit to grant me yours. 'Twas your stalwart heroism that moved the heart of the Great Worm at the last. Any gratitude I can offer is but poor reward for your continued service to Ishgard.
T'would seem our final reckoning with the Dread Worm is at hand. I only wish we had some inkling as to when he means to strike.
It has begun. We must away to Ishgard.
Sees he all in?
Aye. I must return to my city without delay.
Snargan. Skull. Ses Nitek.
Thank you. Remember your training! We hold fast until the Lord Commander returns. We must hold.
By the Fury, that one is the size of Nidhogg. You are late, Warrior of Light.
Watan and by E. Still walking. Nal U in Da. Ale El Ikinfa and Kohesdo.
Thank you.
In Eskidramik in. In Faun Er. Wormo ite to Thar an. In this an in. Snalisway in. Nedwo. Elstra.
Death on afterthought to those who fight for not alone, lying empty, a brain. Children of the land, do you hear echoes of truths that once rang clear? Two souls intertwined, one true love they did find, bringing land and heaven's knees.
Meet me.
Thank you.
Estinian!
Is this to be mine end? Nay, I will not allow it. I am of the first brood. I am vengeance incarnate. I am Nidhogg! Thou shalt die by my hand! This is not your hand, worm! No! Thou wilt obey! I would ask one last favor of you, Warrior of Light. Finish me! Now, while I have the beast subdued! Waste your time! Kill me! It is the only way! Ending Nidhogg will be my final duty!
No! You can't die like this! I won't let you! Cast them into the abyss!
Yet this bond of hope, my treachery was broke, scattering her words.
Minnie said I forgot to lock out ... wasn't expecting to be out all night lol.
He lives. Ah, Astinian, my ill-fated friend. Lucia, summon the healers. I want them ready to receive him.
At once, Lord Commander.
Allow me to do this much, at least. My gratitude, Res Velga. Your deeds this day have saved a great many lives.
The battle is won. We can do no more for Astinian now than bear him home and wish him well. Even as Res Velga did. The rest we must trust to the hands of the healers and the grace of the gods.
Thank you.
The heroes of the hour return.
We but did our duty, my lord. It was the memories of fallen friends and not our heroism which saw us through at the last.
I gave every ounce of my strength, but mine efforts would have counted for naught had the Warrior of Light not arrived to challenge the Great Worm. As a sworn knight of Ishgard, I had hoped to do more for my city.
Well, we cannot all be heroes, dear brother. Let us put away our pride for a moment and revel in the valiant deeds of our comrade. For your sterling service to Ishgard, we salute you. And while we're on the subject of valiant deeds, I believe I myself have earned some small measure of recognition. Under my watchful command, the ballistas of the Outer Ward struck down a veritable swarm of Dravanian invaders.
My lord's command was certainly watchful. He bravely watched as the siege crews took aim, and continued to watch as countless wyverns met their end. Indeed, the ward's defenders proved so well-drilled that my lord had little occasion to stop watching.
There will be time enough to determine who is most deserving of recognition later. Our friends are doubtless weary from their exertions. I had chambers prepared in expectation of your return. You are welcome to retire at your leisure.
I am most grateful for your hospitality, my lord, but I believe I shall pay a visit to the Temple Knight's infirmary. Pray excuse me.
Our master Alphino has grown. The plight of his stricken brother in arms pains him more than his own hurts. In which respect he has come to resemble you, Warrior of Light. Go then, visit the Azure Dragoon, and grant him what comfort you may.
Estinian!
Cease your mewling, boy. It grates my ears.
Forgive me. When I saw you awaken, I could not... It was such a relief. We feared you might never wake up.
Now, Estinian. If Master Alphino thought any less of you, you would still be Nidhogg's plaything. Or dead.
Aye, 'twas but a jest. I thank you, Alphino. And you too, Warrior of Light. Quite how you managed to persuade Hraesvogr to aid in his brood brother's downfall, I cannot imagine. But full glad am I that you did. Yet again, you have achieved the impossible.
I, for my part, owe you an apology. When last we met, I did willingly loose an arrow at your heart. Can you forgive me?
There is naught to forgive, Hemeric. You but acted in defense of Ishgard, as is your duty. Were you any less single-minded about it, I would not follow you into battle, nor trust you at my back. Besides, I had come to the selfsame conclusion that I would have to perish for Nidhogg to be stopped. So let us dispense with the hand-wringing. I have heard enough mewling for one day.
Oh!
The tendrils of Nidhogg's foul presence bound up every fiber of my being, usurping my senses, but I yet retained some trace of awareness. The worm's mind was as a vast and tumultuous sea. Endlessly its black waters churned, his grief and despair at Ratatoska's murder never calming, never receding. Driven by this surging current came wave upon wave of unrelenting rancor. It was the very image of my own heart. There I saw the dark reflection of the hatred I felt after Nidhogg slew my family. When no path remained save vengeance against dragonkind. Neither one of us had a choice. But I was blessed with something Nidhogg was not. Comrades and teachers to console and admonish me. Had I not had them to gainsay my obsession, it would surely have consumed me as Nidhogg's did him, and we would have been in all respects alike. Though his shade is banished, his spirit scattered upon the sea of clouds, I feel no joy at his passing. Where once I craved vengeance, I now crave rest. Lord Commander, my hunt is at an end. I would lay down the mantle of Azure Dragoon.
My friend.
He has tired himself with too many words. I doubt not that he will make a full recovery, but he must be allowed some few days of quiet. I too must see my path to its end. Sleep well, my friend.
Following the battle with Nidhogg on the steps of Faith, Sir Emery called an assembly that he might make his final proclamation as acting head of state. T'was there, with one decree, that the 1,000-year rule of the archbishops was ended, paving the way for a new republic. The governance of Ishgard would now be placed in the hands of high and lowborn alike, their ranks represented by the newly founded House of Lords and House of Commons. Church was separated from state. The foundation for change had been carefully laid, and the reforms proposed by Ishgard's new government passed into law without incident. His duty done, Emeric de Borel gladly stepped down from the Archbishop's dais, only to be raised unto the highest seat in the House of Lords. Though he strove at first to refuse this honor, the unexpectedly strident voice of the Count de Durandere left him little choice but to accept. And so it was that the winds of gentle revolution came to stir. Prominent among the many honored guests at Sir Emeric's investiture were the ambassadors of Dragonkind, a fitting symbol of Ishgard's newfound peace. People looked on in awe as he soared through the heavens on dragon back, and by their cheers did they hail him an Azure Dragoon for a new age. Thus were the notes of the dragon song rewritten, the din of war giving way to a rising litany of peace and hope.
Yeah.